want to thank you for joining us for worship on this Maundy Thursday worship evening. We come together acknowledging that Christ, our Savior, came to die for our sins. Jesus said, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it." Let us go to God in prayer. Eternal Father, as we come together this evening, we confess that often our spirit has not been that of Christ, where we have failed to love one another as he has loved us, where we have pledged loyalty to him with our lips, and then betrayed, deserted, or denied him. Forgive us, we pray, and by your Spirit, make us faithful in every time of trial through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray it. Amen. When we think of the Last Supper that the disciples attended with Jesus, and then their attendance with him to pray on the Mount of Olives, and then his arrest and the beginning of his passion. We come together acknowledging that our sin has cost the Christ his life. For God has loved us so much that he sent Jesus, his Son, into this world to save us, to offer him as a sacrifice for our sins. It is appropriate then that we would confess our sins before God and one another. My sisters and brothers, Christ shows his love by becoming an humble servant and drawing near to God. We confess our sin in truth, knowing that God's Spirit listens to us. Who is in a position to condemn? Only the Christ. But Christ suffered and died for us and was raised from the dead and ascended on high for us and continues to intercede for us. Believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let's take time now to affirm our faith in God using the Apostles' Creed, number 881, in our hymnals.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We want to take time to continue to lift up names that are on our prayer list. We continue to pray for Bud Choate, Steve Lawrence, Pat Crabtree, Dean McCain, Richard Gillum, Kathleen Balloon, Dwight Atkinson, Barbara Pfeiffer, Jeremy Cheatham, A.R. Walters, our nursing home residents. We know that there are other names that you may be praying for on this evening. We ask that as we go to God now in silent prayer, that those names be lifted up, for we know that God intercedes according to the power of His Spirit. He knows our thoughts. He knows our hearts. Let's go in silent prayer now and listen to what God has to say to us. Let us pray. Eternal Father, on the night in which you were arrested, you instituted a remembrance that we too are to be servants of one another, that we are to love one another. In fact, that was the new command that you gave. When we come together, we acknowledge that we are servants. So help us set aside our pride. Help us set aside the petty differences and the bickering, the drama that so often asserts itself because of our selfishness and pride. Help us then, Lord, that we might be free to serve you by the power of your Spirit, that we might learn to love again, even as you loved your own disciples and love us. And we thank you that you willingly offered yourself as a sacrifice for us. As we approach an Easter where we will celebrate, we know that there is also a time for us to mourn, a time for mourning for our sin, for the cost that God would send his only Son into this world to save us by offering himself as that sacrifice made in his own blood. So tonight, humble us, help us to remember the cost of our salvation, and most of all, help us to glorify the God who has loved us and is always faithful. We give thanks now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And we pray also that prayer he taught his own disciples. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In Scripture to John's Gospel. We'll be going to the 13th chapter beginning at the 18th verse. John chapter 13 beginning at the 18th verse. Jesus said, I am not referring to all of you. I know those I have chosen. But this is to fulfill the scripture. He who shares my bread has lifted up his heel against me. I am telling you now before it happens, so that when it does happen to you, you will believe that I am he. I tell you the truth, whoever accepts anyone I send accepts me, and whoever accepts me accepts the one who sent me. After he had said this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and testified, I tell you the truth, one of you is going to betray me. His disciples stared at one another, at a loss to know which of them he meant. And one of them, the disciple whom Jesus loved, was reclining next to him. Simon Peter motioned to this disciple and said, ask him which one he means. And leaning back against Jesus, he asked him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, it is the one to whom I will give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish. Then dipping the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, son of Simon. As soon as Judas took the bread, Satan entered into him. What you are about to do quickly, Jesus told him. But no one at the meal understood why Jesus said this to him. Since Judas had charge of the money, some thought Jesus was telling him to buy what was needed at the feast or to give something to the poor. And as soon as Judas had taken the bread, he went out, and it was night. When he was gone, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God is glorified in him, God will glorify the Son in himself and will glorify him at once. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me. And just as I told the Jews, I tell you now, where I am going, you cannot come. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Eternal Father, as we listen once again to your word and contemplate it, help us to understand the sacrifice that has been made for us. Help us to understand the great love of God that reaches out to us through Jesus the Christ. And may we indeed learn to love even as Jesus loved us. We give thanks now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to talk about the hardest commandment tonight. And of course, that commandment would be to love one another, even as Christ has loved us. Now, here's a fun fact. Many of you have pets at home, and I don't know if you're a dog person or a cat person, but listen up. Cats can understand at least 56 vocal commands. They just choose to ignore all of them. Well, now, if you're a cat lover, you can just replace those words with dog, and you'll get the gist of this. But I do want to point out, if you are a Christian, you probably listen just about as well to God as your cat or dog listens to you. Now, that's not as funny as it would seem, of course. Our scripture for this Maundy Thursday brings us to a familiar scene. Jesus at the Last Supper with his disciples. I purposely left out the usual lessons about Jesus sharing the Passover Seder, the sacrificial remembrances that we so often associate with Holy Communion, and the foot washing lesson on service, because I want to pause and look again at the heart of what God is doing, which of course is to show us the love of the Father through Jesus. The first faith lesson is that love does not come easy to you or to me. Folks, that is one of the lessons of human history that we don't have to look very far to see, that people and nations don't love one another. In fact, our land is filled with divorce because people have stopped loving one another. In fact, if it was even love at all at the beginning. We remember that the gospel echo the command to love was first given to the Hebrews by Moses. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus has to contend with the Pharisee who sought to let legalism triumph over love. One of them, the scripture says, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law?" And Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." Jesus is telling us that love is the central theme of the Bible. It is our purpose, which is to learn to love even as God has loved us. Isn't it strange that we would have to be commanded to love? One only has to watch toddlers for a few minutes in a nursery to learn what nature really lives inside human beings. We see how much those little ones need the love and affirmation of those who care for them, but at the same time we see how hard it is for them to share and to love one another. Those characteristics stay with us not just through our toddler years, but they stay with us throughout our lives. We have to struggle against our selfish nature, which is not to love. In fact, love is a learned behavior. Adults need the love and affirmation of God to feel good about themselves. While at the same time, we have a problem because our selfish impulses often override our knowledge that we need to care for others in love and share that love with others. In other words, loving others like we love ourselves is learned behavior, and it's difficult at any age. Let us not forget the lesson that this Bible was written for, which is that we might learn to love even as God has loved us. The second faith lesson is that Jesus had the perfect setting to show what the greatest love of all looked like. It's apparent from reading the Gospels that Jesus knew from the very beginning of his ministry exactly who it was that would betray him. There was no surprise when Judas betrayed Jesus. It might have been to those disciples, but not to the Lord. God is not in the business of forcing us to do anything against our will. We have been given the ability to choose what we would like to do. And boy, do we like to do lots of things, but we seldom like to do what God wants us to do. Nevertheless, God's grasp of what will be often befuddles us who only have 20/20 hindsight. In the vast love of God, Judas is even offered a seat at the final meal with the other disciples, despite Jesus knowing that Satan will enter into him and poison his mind. This is a picture of a God who loves us evermore, who always has loved us, who has compassion for his children. Even when it seems that his children have forsaken him, God is still calling his children back. Human beings in general have hearts that are easily invaded by secret hatreds when we discover that someone we trust is actually against us. Oh boy, do we begin to turn on the heat then. We'll turn on the passion and the arguing and the bitterness. We will go to extremes when we find out that someone's heart is against us. Our natural tendency, of course, is not to love, but away from love. And Jesus, on the other hand, loved us sinners in spite of our failures. Our love is not the divine love. This fact points to the very heart of God's love. God sees each of us as redeemable if we can only open ourselves up to the great love that we can learn from Jesus our Lord. Folks, love is certainly a learned behavior. And it is only by the power of God's Spirit living within us that we can learn to love even as God has loved. Because left to ourselves, we will begin to despise and to hate anyone who is not like us. I've mentioned on other occasions when we take Holy Communion the very fact that Middle Eastern custom exists of seating someone at your table, that being a sign of grace, of friendship, of someone being acknowledged as being a part of the family. And when those disciples were seated with Jesus at that last meal, they recognized that God was present for them and that they were acceptable to their Lord. Jesus chose to seat even Judas as a sign of God's grace, extending it to Judas, a sinner. And that's a sign to us who are sinners as well, in the hope that we might love even in the face of our human nature, and that we might accept the Lord's love and come back to the one who has loved us always. God seats us and invites us to this communion table so that we too might understand the great and accepting love of a God who's loved us even while we were yet sinners, proving God's love for us. This is a fact we ought to acknowledge each time we're at God's table. Jesus, we know, went on to comfort the disciples because they were distressed at his disclosure that he was going to leave them. And we understand that even in his leaving them, that he was to go to the cross in the greatest act of love that has ever been demonstrated. Those disciples didn't understand it at that moment, but after the resurrection and Jesus returned, it all became very clear how deep the Father's love was for his children. God came into this world in Jesus the Christ to become an atoning sacrifice so that we might see how deep and great God's love was, and that we might not have to suffer the penalty for our selfishness and our journeys into sin. The last faith lesson is that our attention to loving others is unfortunately like that of those little toddlers. Folks, we have to pay close attention to be the kind of person that God wants us to be, to love as God wants us to love. It is so easy for our human nature to take over and for us to overlook anyone and everyone. In fact, in verse 33, Jesus speaks from his heart to his disciples. "My children, I will be with you only a little longer." This is the voice of God pleading with the disciples and therefore pleading with you and me. Please pay attention. This is important in so many words. And so Jesus reminds the disciples that others haven't listened. So it's important that they must listen. And folks, in this world today, so many are not listening, and it's important for you and for me to listen up. Listen. God will not contend with us forever. We need to pay attention because God is trying to teach us the most important lesson of all, which is to love one another, even as he has loved us. Jesus goes so far as to say that what he is telling them is a new commandment, when in fact, of course, it's the oldest commandment of all. Love one another just as he was loving them. Things are precious, often because of our relationship to them. The most precious thing that a mother has is that little baby she holds in her arms. We all love those who are near to us because of our ties by nature. Precious, therefore, in the sight of the Lord are his saints, because they are born into his household by regeneration and made into sons and daughters, because God's Spirit is working within them so that they might return to that love that first made them. Folks, if you really love something, you've got to let it go. You turn it loose. And if it really loves you, it will return to you. And God is calling through Jesus for us to return. And the way that we return is to learn to love, even as he has loved us. To listen to the truth he has to speak into our hearts, and to let his Spirit enter into us and begin to live within us. Don't for a minute think that God our Father has less affection toward his children than we have towards our own. Not at all. No mother's heart has ever yearned over her child, and no father's being ever rejoiced over his offspring as the heart of God yearns for his children to return to him, to learn from him, to be like him. On this Holy Week, we remember the passion of our Lord. Scholars and medical experts have told us the way in which Jesus was abused and suffered and died on that cruel cross. But in a more poignant search of the facts, we can also conclude that Jesus died not just of loss of blood or from lack of being able to pull himself back up against those nails. Jesus died of a broken heart on that cross because of the children that would not return to God's love. The failure of human compassion and love put Jesus on that cross. And it's only the redemption of human compassion and love by believers that can make Jesus' sacrifice worthy. The Lenten season is a time for inner reflection on the cost of our sin. We should have loved, but haven't. We need to love, but aren't. Folks, we are guilty. Our sin has placed Jesus on the cross. God's love is so great, so overpowering, that He would condescend to become a human being and live and be rejected by people like you and me, so that He could offer Himself up as a sacrifice. So great is the Father's love in Jesus. So that we move beyond our selfish thinking, we take time to think together tonight, to remember once again the passion and the sacrifice, all in the name of the love of a God who is calling us. So let God's Holy Spirit move us to properly love one another and to return to that great love that God has for us. Let that be our sole ambition. If we only learn one thing, let us learn to love as God has loved. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I normally send us out with a benediction, but I send us out in silence tonight because we stand at the foot of a cross and our Savior has been nailed to it. May we contemplate on the love of God until that resurrection morning. Amen.